you sit in the middle. Hi, everybody. Welcome to Attitudes. I'm Linda Dano.
Hi, I'm Dee Kelly. Boy, what energy we have.
Nice day, nice audience.
Yes,
nice everything.
Good weather, yes.
Yeah. And guess who's back, you guys?
Our favorite.
Sonia Hamlin.
Yes. Oh. Now, tell us what she's doing.
No fault fighting.
What? Has she told you exactly what that means? I know she likes to wait.
Yeah, she did wait. I'm not quite sure. Do you fight?
I mean, yes.
You do. Well, you're Irish, you know. And are you a fair fighter?
Probably not. No.
Do you like to fight?
There's someone sitting in this audience today that will
kill you.
Yes. Yeah. No. I know what you do. You just go.
Yeah,
okay.
I'm like a real wuss. I really am.
I just pull back
and go, huh? Mm-hmm. You're right. I do all those things. Ma, yeah.
Well, but she's going to tell us how not to do that?
She's going to tell us how you can constructively have an argument that's nobody's fault, that you actually can...
So it's a win-win thing.
A win-win
thing. As opposed to win-lose. Great.
She's fabulous. So if we all just listen to Sonia, we'll all have healthy, nice relationships, I hope.
Well, now, and we have some gorgeous men with us today. GQ Magazine is here with men's fashions.
Oh.
And that's going to be, everybody's going to know the audience. Yeah. The women are going, oh, well,
forget Sonia. Where are the guys?
Yeah.
That's right.
Great.
That's right. So. And Jean is back, our mechanic.
That's good.
We're gonna show you all how to winterize your car and how to jump it or...
Jump it.
Jump
how to jump our car. As a matter of fact, we learned this morning in rehearsal, just briefly, we haven't done it actually, so get ready.
Yeah. Don't hold your breath
Linda
for this.
Linda Dee on parade. But we've been jumping them the wrong way for quite a while, it seems.
Yeah,
could have blown up, actually.
Blown up the car.
Yeah.
I call people, you see. But Jean's going to show us how to do that.
I don't know if they have those kind of problems out on the farm. What do you think?
I don't know.
Where this guy
Shall we
comes
set
from?
This whole thing?
Yeah.
It's a Montana farm.
We want you
the
to picture this.
The boy doctoring the calves and harvesting the bean fields on the family farm.
Right.
He works hard, yet all the time he knows that life has bigger and better times in store for him. So he picks up and he moves west.
That's right. And I know it sounds like a script for a Hollywood flick, but it is the true story behind our first guest. With a few detours along the way, he went from the farm, from Montana, straight to the top of a primetime series.
Yeah.
You know him as Dodger in the ABC television hit China Beach, and you're sure to see even more of this talented guy. Boy, he's great.
He is talented.
In the future. Please welcome Jeff Kober.
Come on out, Jeff.
You really did grow up on a farm.
Yes, I did, yeah.
And starting at what, around 8 years old, I read you were milking cows and harvesting and...
I didn't start milking until I was 11, actually.
Oh.
That's close.
That's too young to milk a cow, huh? Didn't think I'm joking. Is this funny?
Is like right up there with the shortening.
Right.
It's been a long time since I milked a cow, I guess. I'm just.
Really, you don't go back just for like a refresher thing?
The cow died.
The cow. You only had one cow.
The cow died.
One cow.
Oh, dear. How
and
sad.
We were worried you were cool. We're not worried anymore.
Jeff, did you know when you were a kid that you wanted to be an actor?
Not at all. Where I came from, actors weren't the same as those of us who milk cows. And
what
and
does that,
sort that of
mean?
Thing. I just never knew that it was possible. You saw people in the movies and on TV, and you didn't think that those were ordinary people.
Yeah. Isn't that interesting?
Yeah. Yeah. Now, when did it all happen? You're now a wonderful actor. When did
Thank
the
you.
Bug strike?
I was in a very bad rock and roll band, which died.
Is this one of your detours that we were talking about?
Yeah, the last in a long series of them. And I went to an acting class and loved it.
Just accidentally? You just said, well, I'll try this?
I needed a class. You know, I went to college several times. And I remembered that...
several times, I love that.
Classes made sense. Lucky. You went in and you did something and you took a test and they said, good job or bad job. It made sense. And I was, you know, I just, I needed a class and someone suggested an acting class and that was it.
Now, interesting.
That brought you your work and everything, but talking about your personal life, you have a family and now a 3-month-old son.
Three and a half.
Three and a half months. And we have a picture of him.
Let's see. Oh, look.
What a nice family.
Look at this.
What is his name?
It's the first time I've been away from him. That's Henry.
Oh, that's Henry. And your wife's name is?
Rhonda.
Rhonda. Is she an actress?
No, she's in development, producing.
Oh, so she does somewhat the same kind of business, so she understands.
We're all in the same business, but I couldn't handle it with an actress, I don't think.
Interesting. I don't think I could have either.
Oh, jeez.
No, that's tough. Two actors together, that's tough.
Yeah. Now, where do you live with them? In Hollywood?
Hancock Park, just near Hollywood, yeah.
Do you wish you could raise your son in Montana? I mean, are you nervous about that, you know?
I want him to find out about working and about, you know, living outside. And I'd like to take him to Montana.
Yeah, I bet. Mm-hmm. I bet.
We have a clip of China Beach that you're so marvelous on. Why don't we take a look at it?
Okay.
Let everybody else see.
I made it. They're dead.
Not part of the Vietnam War. What do you use to draw on for this character? Because that was really excellent.
Well, the man is going through an experience that is a personally and humanly damaging experience. I think we all have those in our lives somewhere, to whatever extent we have them. And what's a tragedy to you may not be a tragedy to me and vice versa, but we all have our own tragedies, and you draw upon that. Put yourself in that situation.
Yeah. You went to Vietnam with Dana Delaney and another member of your cast?
No, just the two of us.
We have some stills here. Here's Vietnam. And how long ago was this?
This was last September, a year ago.
Now, why did you go? You felt you needed to?
It's a great excuse for a vacation.
Yes, that's true.
That was China Beach.
That's the real China
Beach.
Yeah,
that's China Beach.
Is it beautiful there?
It really is gorgeous, very pastoral, it's very poor. Mm. The people are very industrious. They live on the streets, basically. That's where they do their washing. These people actually do live on the streets. Mm. They were beautiful people. It was a wonderful experience. I'm really glad I went. I got a sense of the countryside, of the way it smelled. It has a real distinct...
Do you think it affects your work when you came back? Did you feel closer to it somehow?
It made it deeper and harder, because I realized that I grew up with the war on my TV set.
Yes.
And they were the enemy, they were the Vietnamese. Mm. And I didn't realize it until sitting in a restaurant in Saigon that I never thought of them as people. When I saw, I was looking through a book of photos, there's a restaurant set in an attorney's library, Madame Dai's. And I was looking through a book of photos and I saw Vietnamese women crying over their dead husbands, their dead children. And for the first time ever, they were mothers crying for their children rather than Vietnamese crying for their dead. And I found that I had to stop reading things about the Vietnamese because I was starting to empathize too much with them. And in order to do my work, I couldn't do that. So it made it harder. Yeah. But I think it had to have deepened it as well.
Mm. I'm sure. You're a wonderful actor.
Thank you very much.
Look forward to seeing you in China Beach and other things.
Yes.
Thanks for being
joining
us.
Thank
you. Jeff Kober.
Stay right there.
Well, if your man is spending more time in front of the mirror than ever before, find out about his new attitude next. That was wonderful. This is an update on the man or men in your life, so you better listen carefully. Did you know that over half of American adult males spend anywhere from 30 to 45 minutes per day on grooming?
And that almost 70% agreed that no matter what women say about personality and brains, they always go for good looking and well dressed first.
Well, here to tell and show all are two experts from the magazine that knows all about men, GQ. Say hello to fashion editor Nani Moore and fashion marketing director Ed Manischewski.
Hello, Ed. Hello, Nani.
Hello.
Thanks for coming. It's good to be here.
Ed, let me ask you the first question. This survey that we just were giving the percentages of, this
was
done for GQ?
That's right. It's called the American Male Opinion Index. And we thought it was high time that we take a look at how men view themselves and the world around them. And one thing is for sure, there's no such thing as the typical man, contrary to popular belief. Particularly, we're seeing that men are far more interested in the areas of impressions management and grooming than we'd thought possible.
So they're getting more like us?
In many ways. They certainly are more interested, as I mentioned, in appearance, but they are still different from women as to why they're motivated to do so.
Oh, interesting.
Now, do you think that they're vainer now than they were years ago? Nani, what do you think? Do you think that men are becoming more vain, or have they always been, but just perhaps more quietly?
They probably always have been, just as women have been. But now they're allowed to experiment more.
Yeah.
There are far more choices for them. There's more interest.
How is it changing fashion-wise?
Well, fashion.
Has it made great strides?
Yeah, great in the last few years. There's a much more natural shape, more color. Men are they're easier about trying new ideas, and it's more comfortable for
them. Is that generally for most men? I mean, we'll always have the really fashion plate kind of guys. But, I mean, are most men now looking at GQ and going, I could wear that, I sort of like that, and doing it?
Yeah, they are, definitely.
That's great.
And travels around the country, so he talks to them all.
Absolutely, and the majority of the men in our research absolutely concurred with that point of view. Over half the men, 52% of the men in our research, said that they owed it to themselves to look their very best, and that's a profound change.
Great. And not for women, but really for them first.
For themselves, to look good and to feel good about it.
Well, let's see.
Now, you brought some
guys
clothes.
Looking very
some
good.
Clothes. Yep.
Now, these are from all different designers, right?
They're from 9 top American designers.
Okay. Wonderful.
And they're the new shapes, the new colors. The first one is done by Bill Robinson, one of our top designers, and it's the new duffel. It's in a new olive nylon with a bright orange lining.
I love this.
And a burgundy turtleneck. So he's really mixing color in an interesting way, and yet it's very easy.
Men are getting much more in tune with color, aren't they?
And much more.
Yeah, because we see it a lot.
They're not afraid to wear color.
Good.
And the leather jacket, it's very important this fall. We're showing a lot of them. And this one is done by Jane Barnes, one of our women designers. And it's over a textured brown sweater.
Are men more comfort-oriented in their clothing than women, do you think?
Yeah, I think they are, but it's got to look good, too. I think that's just as important as comfort.
Yeah.
But their clothes are more comfortable now. And here's...
Go ahead.
This is another new length in outerwear. It's done by Roger Forsyth for Perry Ellis.
Oh, yes.
And it's a new shorter length reversible, worn over a brown cardigan and polo.
You know, I find that the reason I know men are changing is that a lot of men wear, like, jazzy socks and they wear a different color scarf, and they're experimenting more, where they used to wear just black socks. Now they're broadening out.
Well, socks are very important
Very.
In color.
This is wonderful.
This is great. This is the new soft overcoat. In fact, this whole look is soft, because the jacket is a soft crepe sport jacket and a crepe shirt. And it's done by Andrew Fezza.
He's on you.
Now, is the influence for men Europe, or is it television, or is it sports figures? Where is this new kind of freedom coming from?
There's a lot from Europe, but it's from everywhere. I think it's also obviously a desire for it, or they wouldn't be spending so much. But a lot of the ideas are from Milan has changed the look of men's clothes and its colorings in Paris. And New York design, American designers are great.
Yeah.
So it's coming from everywhere.
And from a psychographic standpoint, our research has shown that men have had to compete with women as never before for many of the same job positions. And, of course, now they have to compete not only with other guys, but for women. So there's a vested economic interest in looking better.
I would have never thought that, but that is true, isn't it?
That's
now, you know, men, too, are doing a whole thing with creams and
skincare.
They're trying skincare and getting their hair permed
and colored.
That's a whole new trend.
It's completely acceptable. It's the idea of looking and feeling good about yourself. We refer to it as personal style. It's a positive self-image and the confidence to express it.
And there's nothing effeminate about it, which was, I think, the fear. Years ago, men were extremely reluctant to put anything on their skin or anything like that, and it's not the case now. They know they have to take care of their face.
Absolutely. Sun care products, grooming products.
Facials.
The idea, again, the idea is all nurturing this towards a point of self-actualization, the idea that I can be the best that I can possibly be.
Okay.
Well, we have some more. Let's take
let's
a look.
Let's see some more clothes. Okay. All right, Nani, what are we looking at?
Oh, this is stunning.
This is wonderful. This is a combination of tweed and suede.
Nice.
It's done by Joseph Abu in a Czech sport coat and a brown suede vest. The vests are really important in sport. They look great.
This is a new look, isn't it? Without the tie.
Yeah.
The buttoned up shirt and no tie.
And the denim shirt.
And the denim shirt. See the blue mixed with the green, how great it looks.
Ed, how are the men responding to your fashion shows? You're doing a nine designer tour of nine cities.
That's right, called Designs on Men, and the response has been overwhelming. Men are getting out there and they're shopping, they have a point of view and a taste level, and they're not afraid to go out there and spend money on quality fashion that they feel they can get a lot of use out of.
Suede is so big.
Who is this, honey? This is Jeffrey Banks, and it's no tie dressing. See, it's a suit with a dark
with
gray
no
shirt
tie. And no tie.
So it's more than sportswear, it's really a suit look.
Now, this is the more traditional look,
right?
Yeah,
it's a modern look for business, that pique lapel, the square shoulder, and the slight fit. And then we've made it, that deep blue shirt. Kind of like what Ed has one on right now, too.
Yeah, that's
a very rich look, that blue.
I also like the brown shoes.
Right, brown suede shoes and patterned socks.
Yeah. Oh, look at these.
Go ahead, Ed.
That silhouette is terrific for the guy who's taking better care of himself. It really fits the younger executive between the ages of 25 to 49.
Working out and...
Now look at this,
this color. Bright, bright color. This is Cecilia Matheny, and look at that bright graphic tie with it. It's pretty daring, but it's still understandable. It's great looking.
So you were saying that men don't just buy something because it wears out. They're buying things like fashion. They're going to the stores to really get by a look.
That's right. Their patterns are becoming much more closely aligned to women's wear shopping behavior.
And this is by Rinalda Shamas, one of our really bright new designers who did women's wear, and I was doing both men's wear as well.
Beautiful.
So he uses color really daringly in this cognac jacket with a green sweater.
Do you think that men really care about what women think of how they're dressed?
Well, they do to a degree. I mean, we're seeing that about half men in our research said that, yes, they agreed to take a woman along while they were shopping, and they thought that their judgment was important. But when we asked them if they actually enjoyed getting that advice, that figure plummeted to 25%.
Really?
Yeah.
So, ladies, leave your guys alone. Let them go and shop.
Let them shop.
Let them do what they want to do.
Thank you for being here.
It was a pleasure.
Thank you, both of you.
Well, it was good to see you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Listen to these words and see if they sound at all familiar. How did you pay for that? I told you not to use the charge cards anymore this month. Why did you tell the kids they could see that movie? I already told them they couldn't. Well, if this conversation rings a bell, don't feel bad. All couples argue about something. And today we're going to learn about no-fault fighting. And who better to teach us than our favorite communications expert, author of the book, How to Talk So People Listen, and my pal, Sonia Hamlin. Hi, Sonia.
Hi, Jeff.
Nice to have you back, always.
Thank you.
Now, do most people fight? Most couples?
Yeah, most couples fight, and I worry about the couples who say they never fight. Because, you know, marriage or living together is such a tough thing. They are not twins. They are not clones. They come from opposite places. They have different tastes, different body rhythms. They like different things. Their parents behave differently towards them and towards each other. And suddenly, this peculiar little couple has to get together and go one path,
forever.
In sync. Yeah. It doesn't really work. Yeah. So there have to be times with abrasion and problems. And the question is, what do you call fighting? See, some people are very lethal and extremely nasty, and they never raise their voice. But that's fighting.
I hate those.
Me too. I like a lot of noise.
I like you to yell a little bit.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Now, what is no-fault fighting?
The other half of no-fault fighting is win-win.
Yeah.
You both have to be able to get something, or the argument isn't over. If I walk out triumphant, and you are down in the dirt, we haven't really finished it, because you got to come back up again, and there'll be some way that you're going to get it.
How can you both win, though?
Uh-huh. It has to do with nothing is 100% on either side. And that's a peculiar thing. You know, we always thought the best is 100%. That's not true. You can't make it with 100%, because that means the other one gets zero. You both have to be willing to get some of it solved and save the rest for another day.
So you have to learn to compromise or to step back a little bit and give a little?
I mean, yeah, the world
that's
hates
hard.
That. I know.
Sonia,
the world hates
hard.
That. And the hardest time, I think, is when people have steam up. Then it's very hard to think, now, calm down, my dear. 50% is better than nothing, because you're not really in that mode. I like to suggest that you get to thinking about that before you ever get into an argument. If we could sort of pull apart an argument. I mean, let me ask you a question.
Right.
Do you argue with a certain frank person?
Frank and I have, you know, we have our disagreements. I am one of those real chickens. I do not like to fight. So what happens is, if he comes after me about something, I withdraw, which is like a terrible thing to do. I should, those occasions that I stand up for myself or say, you know what, Frank, I don't agree with you. This is how I feel. It's a lot healthier.
Yes.
But I don't ever know that, and I don't do it enough. I continue to withdraw.
Why do you do that?
I think it's because I'm afraid that something is going to go haywire. Yeah, like he's going to leave me, or he's going to hate me.
Or that you'll get out of control if you say
maybe.
What you really mean.
Maybe.
So what you're doing is this,
right?
And he sort of gets it all, or gets it for that time, but it doesn't go away. There must be
because
other...
I sit on it, and then I hate him for it.
Yes.
Right? Oh, you all know that.
And then you seethe with it, which is a big problem, big problem.
So now, what would I do? Like, Frank will say to me, he'll come after me. And we mostly argue about what he thinks, forgive me, Frank, what he thinks I'm not doing.
Yes.
Right.
Does that sound familiar to anybody out there?
Right. Right. And so I get very hurt.
Yes.
And I'm much too emotional.
Yes.
And then he'll say something to me like, what are you getting your period? Which then I want to stab him in the chest. And it goes downhill from there.
Start, how does it start? What's the beginning? What would be the first thing he says? Linda, you
didn't do, or you didn't, you know, I thought, you know, years ago when I came home, you would have some dinner. I mean, really, like candles. I mean, those days are certainly over.
But what he's also saying is, Linda, you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now let me suggest another way.
Okay.
And I hope Frank is listening.
He will be, don't worry. I'll tape it.
But it's kind of good for everybody.
Okay.
He's got to lose in one way or another if he starts out saying, Linda, you. See how the two of us are looking at each other?
Right.
The crackling is between us. I am blaming you. Do you know what happens if I do that? What do? You recoil.
I do that.
Sure. Some people go that back.
See, I don't do that.
Right. But you are responding to the attack. Have you heard what he's talking about? You couldn't possibly. You're busy saving your eyes. I don't, you know, help me. How could you possibly? So if we attack the person, we have lost the ball game right away because the problem never gets solved. Let's say he's got a problem and he'd like once a week for you to come home early with a little dainty apron and, you know, make dinner, and he would love it, and you're sitting there saying, here's all this gorgeous food. He can't get it if he says, you always do this wrong, because first you have to protect yourself and say, I am a good person. Instead, if he were to say, you know what, hon? I have a problem. And the problem is that, I don't know, maybe it's kind of silly, but I would really love it if, like, once a week I kind of got very special attention. And I would like to have dinner on the table and you kind of hanging around. And what do you think about my problem? Now, do you notice that I never looked at you at all?
Yeah, why did you do that?
Because I'm telling about my problem. I am only an expert about my problem. I'm not an expert about you and why you do what you do and how you should do it differently. I'm an expert about how I feel. If you cut off the other half, which is you should do this and you should fix it and this is what you always do wrong, and only tell your problem, you know what it allows you to do? You can consider his problem.
Yeah.
What can you do?
I can't. Now, how do I get him to do that?
Tell him. Tell him to listen. No, say it. You absolutely have to say it. Frank, you and I have a hard time fighting, and I get all folded up, and I sort of can't get at it, and sometimes I can't really even hear what you're saying. I'm so busy being defensive. Let's suggest something. Think of the problem as an object that you put on the table,
right,
between you and me. You tell about it, and then sit back and let's see what I can do. Now, I will deal with it, and then let's see what we can do. And then you have something to talk about. You can negotiate it. I can't do it on Tuesday, but I'll do it on Wednesday. Well, how about just dessert? Whatever. But you are both able to, you bring yourself to his problem instead of, don't hit me, don't yell at me, I feel bad.
Interesting. Are you sure you wouldn't like to marry me?
What a great idea. And then we'd never fight.
Wrong. Never wrong.
We'll have more with Sonia when we come back.
Sonia, who is teaching us how to fight fair with your mate. We have many audience couples who want some help. So think you can do it. Now, you know, we should make this clear. This is not easy.
Oh,
what we're
no.
talking about.
This is only the beginning prescription. It's only to let you know where you could be thinking about it.
Yeah.
It doesn't then just happen that she walks in and says, so now we're going to do it differently.
Yeah.
And he says, oh, okay.
We're putting it on the table, darling.
Right, instead of into right. each other's eyes. But the ability to give some alternative is one of the ways you begin.
Yeah.
And you just sort of have to keep working
with
it. Sonia,
before you ask a couple something, what happens when you're with somebody who always has to win? He's got it in his mind, or she, that I'm right and that's it. What do you do with that? You got a problem.
Yes. Yes,
yeah.
you do.
Yeah.
Okay, let me not be glib. It is very difficult. One of the things you'd have to find out is why he needs to win. I'm saying he. I assume it's that.
Yeah. Yeah.
How insecure is he in the relationship that he feels he perhaps doesn't win in anything else, and so he has to win the argument?
Oh.
What about his life outside? Whom does he work for? And what is his life like at the office? So that there's only one place where he can finally blow off all the steam and say, now here, by gum, I am the king, right?
That's a good point.
I hope that's right.
That's a good point.
So one of the things you ought to be finding out is what else contributes to that, to find out why.
Okay. Let's talk to our couples.
Okay. Here's a couple. You've been married for 22 years.
Yes.
Yeah, and we talked a little before the show, and I heard an interesting reason for an argument. What do you fight about?
Well, she constantly corrects me in front of others. It drives me up a wall.
Ooh.
That can drive you crazy.
Yeah.
Do you know you do that?
Yes, but I can't break myself of the habit.
Why not?
I just keep forgetting. You know, every time it happens, you know, I say, I won't do it again, and it keeps happening.
Now, tell me what happens when she does it. What do you do?
Well, I generally explode.
Right then and there?
No, I wait until we're generally
okay.
alone. You know.
Let's do a little explosion. We're going to fix it right here. Okay, so you've just come home and she did it again. Tell her, what do you say?
I ask her why.
Do it. Don't say I ask her.
Why'd you correct me that time?
Because you were wrong.
But I wasn't. That was the problem. I was not wrong. I was right.
You know what? I thought you was wrong. You know, but he's usually wrong.
So what we got here is the schoolmistress and the student. He's obviously wrong, and you are saving him. What do you do? Do you work at something?
No, no, no.
But did you used to be a school teacher?
No.
Okay. But you have some reason for feeling that you have to fix him all the time.
She's raised a lot of children.
That may be. Now, one of the problems may be the fact that you think if he's wrong, it will reflect badly on you.
Yeah, maybe. That's probably.
Oh, that's good.
So if you want to fix it, you want to fix him so he shouldn't embarrass you.
Yes.
How long have you had good friends? Long time?
A long time.
Apparently, he isn't doing anything so wrong.
You know, yeah.
Okay, when he points it out to you, do you say, I'm sorry?
Yes.
Yes, she does. Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I have one other thought, a way to help her remember. When she does it in public, you might sometimes say, you're doing it again. You know that thing we talk about. And laugh.
That's good. That's good.
If you can laugh, you can help to remember.
Good idea.
Nicely.
Good
okay,
idea.
Now
Thank
let's
you.
Talk. Here's Thank another you. Couple, and I know that these two are not yet married,
okay.
but thinking about it. Right. What makes the two of you fight?
There isn't one
particular thing.
Oh. You mean you fight all the time?
No.
No. He rides his bike a lot, and we have conflict in time. You know, we don't have enough time for one another. And I get jealous when he's out on his bike, and he's very determined, rides his bike every day, 30 miles every day.
Oh, you race your bike. 30 miles every day?
couple of hours sometimes.
Couple of hours, and then.
So what do you do? Let me hear. You say it to him. He's just come in, and you're.
Can't
furious.
You just take one day off of your bike today?
If I take one day off, I won't win on Sunday.
This goes on and on.
Okay, keep talking.
He never takes a day off.
So he says, okay, I want to win on Sunday.
I have to train every day. This is part of my routine. If I break it, I'm not going to win.
Okay, now I'm going to stop and presume something, because I'm very arrogant. I'm going to do that. Okay. I'm going to presume that you mind because you are jealous of his time, and you want to spend time with him because you love him a lot.
Right.
Have you ever said that to him?
Yes.
And what does he say then?
What do you say?
Love's not going to help me crush him on Sunday.
Okay, so what do you say back?
Then I eventually just give up. It's a no-win situation.
We hear is that we have to get a compromise going here. Is it possible for you to compromise and do it at a time of the day when you wouldn't be able to spend it with her? Like, do you work during the day?
I do.
How about racing at lunchtime so that mornings and evenings when you're together, you could be together?
Well, the races are on Sunday, but we do.
She thinks so. Yeah. You know? So maybe you got to make
unless
your...
Unless I get on the bike and go with them, then I can...
Right, I was going to buy... I was going to get a tandem. I was going to get a tandem for...
Yeah, but that's not for racing.
No, but no. It's still training.
Okay, but I think one of the things I hear is that you haven't yet made your point clear. I don't think he knows that that's as important to you as his bike racing is to him. And that perhaps one of the things you ought to do is sit down, look at the schedule, add it all up, and then talk about how much time you don't get. Sometimes if you don't make it clear, that's a problem because people don't understand. And I think you should get married and give up that bike
racing. Which side are you going? Yeah. Oh, good, Sonia.
Okay, wait a minute. It's right over here. You were the ones I talked to. Right. Now, you said you had an additional issue. What was that?
Well, that generally we fought a lot because our expectations were different.
What do you mean by that?
I expect that he does certain things without me asking.
Come on, certain things like flowers.
Like
and
put away his clothes. Not leave it behind the sofa.
And what about you?
It's true. That's one of the reasons we fight. And
what do you
I
think
feel
about
that I'm not 12 years old any longer. I don't have to have someone tell me to put my sneakers away.
Yeah,
or,
but
you know,
if they're behind the sofa and they don't belong there.
I'm going to make a guess. Your mother may have yelled a lot when you were a kid, but then she gave up. Your mother really did get you to pick up the things from behind the sofa, right?
That's true.
See, she's a neater. And you're sort of, I wouldn't say slaw, but I would say sort of a little messier. So it doesn't matter. What doesn't matter a lot to you matters a lot to her. Is there something that you want that she desperately hasn't given you so far? Like something that you care about?
No, not really. Occasionally, like this weekend, she worked late, came home late, but didn't call that she, to let me know she was going to be late.
Oh! Okay,
and
now that mattered a lot to you, and it didn't.
You know why that's important to me?
Yeah. Why?
Because I'm worried about her.
Yeah,
she was working
till
late in the evening, way past the, you know.
See what a perfect trade-off time this is? Finally, you found out something that matters to him and say, you know what? You know how you felt about that? I care so much because it makes me crazy in my house.
Right.
And begin to share with each other that each of you has certain peculiarities that you care about, and, it, you know, you got to help each other out a little. I think they're all sort of waving at us like we're
waving, they're saying, we could go on with you forever. Is she not wonderful, you guys?
Thank you.
All right, we're all going to try harder.
Yes.
All of us.
And you've got to put it out there. You can't attack.
It's 15 degrees out. Oh. The snow's just beginning to fall.
Oh, great.
The wind's blowing so hard.
Oh, it's going very hard.
You can barely make it into your car without freezing.
It's so cold.
And what happens?
And what happens?
Your car won't start.
And I'm freezing and we're stranded. And I'm very cold. And I'd like to find out what we can do to get our cars out of here. I mean, so we won't get stuck again. Luckily, we have someone to help us.
Yes. Let's welcome Attitude's favorite mechanic, Jean Lindemann.
She has no coat on.
Thank God you're here.
You have no
Jean. Oh, God, you brought the sun.
Very warm.
Michelle, answer, lady.
That's right.
Great. Now,
Jean,
boy, you brought us so many things. Like in an emergency, what do we need?
Well, anyway, we should probably go right to the back of the car.
Okay.
What
okay,
we're going
go to
do is show you how
Follow
to prepare
Jean,
for the winter.
Okay.
I've assembled a kind of an everyday winter kit. Now, this won't make a lot of sense to your viewers in California, but
no?
Your everyday winter emergency kit. We have a little duffel bag with winter clothes, so when you're dressed like this, you can pull on your sweatpants, pull on your boots.
Right.
And a flashlight. I have some Evian. Everybody needs Evian.
What's this,
you know, this is a granola bar. This is emergency food. It'll last probably about 3 days till you get stuck in traffic.
Is that a flashlight?
We'll be right back in here. Yeah, we have a flashlight. Right. And this is a really nice item. It's a lock de-icer for when you take it through the car wash. And then you find out it's 30 below zero and you can't get your doors closed. You can't get the key in the lock, so you put this lock de-icer in there. Okay, we have some windshield washer solvent, nice to keep around because when you run out and it's, you know, all that schmutz is on the street and gets all over your windshield, you can't see. Also, a snow brush, gotta have a snow brush and
a
scraper.
That's very good.
Right.
Yeah.
And if you don't have one, you can use a credit card. One of the ones that's all run up, so if it breaks, you won't miss
it. You won't kill yourself.
Yeah. I like to have a folding shovel. So when you're really stuck, you know, you got a chance to get
Lynn
out.
Lynn has a lot of those.
Folding shovel.
Yeah, she carries it in her bag.
What
is in her pocketbook?
Well, you know, if you get stuck in a snowbank, sometimes you can get yourself out pretty quickly.
I thought maybe your car broke, then you just decided to be somebody's yard.
We got flares.
Make a few bucks, right?
While you're stuck.
Pick up a little extra money.
We have flares. If you're really in trouble, you want to put some flares down. This is my secret weapon here. This is cat litter. Cat litter works better than sand and salt in the trunk, I find, because it doesn't freeze in the winter.
Oh.
And if you're really stuck on ice, you can lay a patch of kitty litter down behind each of your wheels and drive right out. Or you can jack the car up if you're really stuck and put it a little bunch of it underneath each wheel.
And it won't give.
Right, and give you a little bit of traction.
Now, it's a lot less messy than carrying all those cats.
The most important thing, of course, are the jumper cables.
Right, let's take those out.
Because it doesn't matter how well your car runs.
Okay.
If it's dead, it doesn't run at all.
Should you also have a blanket?
Dead car.
Actually, you know, if you're going on a long trip, I beef that up a little bit with a sleeping bag, and you can go all the way up to the camp stove, you know.
Yeah.
Depends on how paranoid
the whole
you are.
Thing.
All right.
Or just get yourself a motel.
Yeah, right.
Now, what do we do?
You know, if...
Oh, sorry.
First of all, it's a good idea to keep your battery in good shape so you won't need this. If a really well-maintained battery in cold weather, in cold climates, only puts out about 40% of the power that it puts out in the summer. And, so what we do to winterize your car is clean off these battery terminals. We
this
start
thing
off,
is the battery.
This is the battery.
Right.
This is a no-maintenance battery. You don't have to take the caps off and put liquid in it.
All that
so
stuff.
What? We're not going to actually clean these terminals, but we have a battery terminal to show you a cleaner. You can unloosen these clamps, scrape off all the junk, put this in here and scrape off that junk and tighten it right down.
What do you clean it with?
Just that battery, that terminal brush.
That's it?
Yeah. So we're going to tighten this up and go right into showing you how to jump this car.
What else would we do? What about windshield wipers and all of that?
Well, before the winter starts, you should check and make sure the rubber on the blades is good. If it isn't, you change the blades. You should have good, clean blades.
Do we have to grease these?
Well, when you get it all cleaned up, it's a good idea to put some Vaseline on the terminals.
Okay.
Okay, so why don't we hook this up? It's a good idea. It's important to know when you jump a car. Both cars should be turned off. They shouldn't be touching.
Okay.
Why don't you take
these? Now, my car is dead.
Your car is dead, and you're the friendly person that's going to help.
Right. Oh, thank you,
friendly
person.
Now, if you remember this way...
That's all right. You can pay me cash. No problem.
You should remember to hook the cables up, and don't touch anything now, live to dead, positive terminals
first. Sort of like our relationship, isn't it, Dee?
Live, now you can tell the positive terminal, the negative terminal is a grounded and only goes to the frame. The positive terminal goes to the starter.
Now, this is a misconception that we all have. We put positive to positive and negative to negative.
Yeah.
Why have we not blown up?
Well, you've been lucky, and there hasn't been as much gas maybe surrounding the car, but if there's a spark, it can blow. So what you want to do, just put the positive, and don't let these things touch each other or other parts of the
car.
Where do I put this? One in each hand, and hook that right onto the terminal really well. Get it right on there.
Yeah, sure, okay.
Very good, and give it a little jiggle to make sure it's on tight.
Give it a little jiggle.
Now, you want to put your positive on.
While
you'll see a little positive sign.
Is this my positive, the red?
And don't let this touch it. Or anything else.
It's hard to...
Don't lay it there.
Don't do that.
Put it in your hand.
I was testing you, Jean.
Maybe I can
I'm on the other end of this!
You're doing fine.
Gene.
Put it right on the positive terminal.
Gene.
Open it up.
I'm trying to open it up.
She's weak today. She's not well.
You're going to have to get your... Holy cow.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. That was hard, wasn't it?
I hated
What's
that.
On the inside?
Okay, now
you're gonna
what?
You're going to hook the negative up. Once again, you go from the live car to the dead car. You hook it up to your terminal.
The live car goes on the negative terminal.
Right. Something like
it's
that.
Like
now, do not put
Penn
that on there.
Do not.
What you want to
terminal.
Do is keep this as far away as possible from the battery in case there are any sparks. So what you want to do is find a bare metal spot on the car to hook it up to.
This is not on the battery.
Don't put it on the battery.
The dead car.
You want to find some bare metal on the frame or the engine block to hook it up to. And squeeze it with both hands. And just put it
right
on top
of there. Can you believe that we've never done this? I mean...
There you go. You can open it up a little bit harder.
Everybody puts it on the negative.
Oh, Lord.
You get in your car. Okay, let's get in our car.
You get in your car.
Okay.
We start the live car first. Get some juice into the battery of the dead car. You fire yours up, Dee.
Now, I shouldn't start mine
No, you
yet.
Just wait. Let it run a second. Now you fire yours
Should
up.
Should I rev this?
Ready?
No.
Ready?
Okay.
Yeah.
What's wrong with it?
Put it in first gear.
Is her car
first
not...
First gear, clutch in.
Not
first
starting?
Very good.
Okay,
Dee.
Voilà. Okay, I turn mine off.
You can turn yours off.
Turn it off?
You should leave yours running. Dee. Now we remove them the same way we put them on.
Okay.
Shall
we'll
I
take
leave
the
mine
negative off?
Off?
First. And the negative.
Negative off first?
The positive off.
Always?
The positive.
Okay.
And that's it. Pretty simple.
We've junked our cars, everybody.
Thank you, Gene.
Was that great?
Terrific.
So operating.
Well, stay with us. All
so
Gene tips will be on our tip sheet. Don't forget our tip sheet so you can find out all this information in our
we'll
tip sheet.
We'll be right back.
Stay with us. Wow. Caught in the snow with your car? You never
yes,
did.
I did in the Bronco.
What happened?
The car broke down.
Yeah.
I was on Route 35.
Right.
Near South Salem, New York.
By
not
yourself?
One person stopped.
No, you're kidding.
Not one.
But
not one.
Didn't you have your Felicia Galant boa with
no.
you? They didn't recognize
you. I stood outside in the cold. I actually waved to people and they waved back. But not one person
you didn't
stopped.
They stopped for autographs, but no.
To receive the Lifetime Attitudes tip sheet with information on today's show, call 1-900-773-4040. Today's show and issue number is 5. The cost of the call and tip sheet is $2. To avoid ordering duplicate tip sheets, please check your issue number before placing the call. If you would like tickets, please send a self-addressed stamped envelope to Attitudes Tickets, 3412 36th Street, Astoria, New York, 11106. Or give us a call at area code 718-706-3575.
Tomorrow afternoon at 3 p.m. 2 Central, exercise your funny bone with 227 star Tuki Smith and work out your waistline with actress Lisa Hartman on Attitudes. Coming up on the Lifetime Afternoon movie, a family of cops become partners against crime when they team up to track down a subway strangler. Debbie Reynolds and Brian McNamara are Detective Sadie and Son. Next, right here on Lifetime.